Hello and thank you so much for joining us today for the webinar, The Bone Ring Technique, New Perspectives in Augmentation. It is my great pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Bernhard Giesenhagen, who is going to present today clinical data on the basis of 12 years' experience to state the possibilities and limitations of the bone ring technique for vertical augmentation and the treatment of three-dimensional bone defects. Dr. Giesenhagen is scientific assistant at the Dental Prosthetics Department at Christian Albrechts University and is specialized in implant dentistry since 1980. He has been a lecturer at numerous education events in Germany and other countries since 1995. Dr. Giesenhagen is medical director of the Pro-Implant Institute of Dental Implantology and Aesthetics and of the International Training Center in Melsungen since 2003. We would like to thank BOTIS for providing an educational grant which makes this lecture possible here today. Please go ahead and use the chat box to send your comments and ask questions during the presentation, and Dr. Giesenhagen will respond to all of you at the end of the lecture. And now, without any further delay, please allow me to turn it over to the expert himself, Dr. Bernhard Giesenhagen.
So, hello everyone. I hope you can hear me well. It's a big pleasure for me and an honor to have the first webinar from the BOTIS company. And of course, my topic is the bone ring technique. Thank you very much for the warm introduction. And I think we can go directly into the topic. I'm located now at the moment in Kassel. I have a private clinic here and also in Frankfurt with my colleague you have seen on the screen, Dr. Orchan Yüksel. And our topic is vertical augmentation of three-dimensional defects with bone rings. And we talking about three-dimensional defects, we talking about vertical augmentation. We don't talk about horizontal augmentation because we know horizontal augmentation is very easily done with particulated bone graft material, but we are only talking about defects where we need we have to use a block. First of all, I want to show you one video, a clinical video, a typical case, what we did some years ago, and it is a case from a young patient comes to our clinic with a defect like that, and you see there is a scar tissue because some weeks before or some months or years before there were some augmentation procedure, but they failed. And now this patient comes to us and we have a scar tissue on the crest, and this is always a little bit more difficult. If you have a scar tissue on the crest, you have of course a bigger risk of a dehiscence of the flap because of some malnutrition of the scar tissue. First of all, I make a horizontal incision on the crest and two vertical cuts very close to the defect. And you can see very close to the defect, we make a vertical cut on both sides. And then I raise the flap to the buccal side. This is always important to see the whole augmentation as a whole defect in total. And then very fast is visible that there are only bone graft particles connected by connective tissue. So I have to remove everything and have to clean this area, and then it's very fast visible what huge defect we have. We have a huge defect, no buccal bone and no palatinal bone. And this is not so easy, this kind of defect design, if you want to find another graft technique, it's not so easy. And first, now I measure the vertical dimension, the bone covering the roots from the adjacent teeth. This bone level is my orientation later for the vertical position of the bone ring. The bone covering the roots from the adjacent teeth. This is my orientation. And then I measure the defect with a trephine mesial distal distance. And in case that bone is covering the roots from the adjacent teeth, like it visible here, I recommend to leave a distance or from approximately 1 millimeter. Then I release the flap. I make a purest incision to release the flap. I do this purest incision right after raising the flap because we know out of the purest a lot of bleeding is coming, and this bleeding stops later when I suture. And now I go in this case to the chin with a special flap design. I open up the chin area. I will talk later a little bit more in detail what you have to respect when you harvest bone from the chin area. And now I mark only the position of the ring. I go only half a millimeter into the cortical bone to mark the position of the bone ring. And then I use all instruments what I need for implant bed preparation. Starting with a round drill, I mark the center. And with all the other instruments, pilot, I penetrate the cortical bone, penetrate the cancellous bone, and go in contact to the lingual cortical bone. The lingual cortical bone is a very hard structured bone, double six and the buccal cortical bone, and so the risk of a fenestration is very low, and you feel exactly the contact. This is the next drill for the implant bed preparation, and then after finishing my implant bed preparation with drills, I use the instrument so-called conical reamer. This is a tool from the Ankylos implant system. With this, I can finally make an implant bed preparation. And only after finishing the implant bed preparation, I use a trephine for the final trephine cutting. The trephine should be used in slow motion, good cooling, and intermittent to avoid the overheating of the bone cells. It's a big instrument, and please intermittent, good cooling, and not too high speed. And also with the trephine, I penetrate cortical bone buccal side, cancellous bone, and go in contact to the lingual cortical bone. Then I have instrument so-called ring knife. With this ring knife, I cut the cancellous bone from the cortical bone on the lingual side away. And with a small rasp, we call it ring remover, we remove the ring out of his bed, and then we remove the ring, put it in a small cup, and we suck out blood out of the defect and store the ring inside of this blood. And in case there are some bone chips, of course you can harvest these bone chips as well and fill up the defect with a collagenous sponge. Suturing the donor side and go back to the recipient side. We fix the implant position with a guide. Very important, the right implant position in the aesthetic area is very important for the aesthetic outcome, of course, the right implant position. Ring bed preparation with a trephine, and then the ring fits very well from the vertical dimension on the bone level from the bone covering the roots from the adjacent teeth. I use the ring as a template and make my implant bed preparation through the ring into the local bone. This is always recommendable, then everything fits very well together, and fix the ring finally with an implant. We use implants, Ankylos implants, and we insert the implants a little bit subcrestal, maybe approximately 1 millimeter. And if the ring has a little bit mobility left, you can fix him very easily, finally, with a so-called membrane screw. This membrane screw has a 6 millimeter diameter, and you give compression with the membrane screw to the ring into the local bone during inserting. And now everything is very stable. I fix a collagenous membrane with two titanium pins, and then I make a final augmentation. For this I use bone chips or non or slowly resorbable bone graft material mixed with blood, and I put a thin layer of non and slowly bone graft material around the graft, and put the membrane under the palatinal mucosa. This is now the augmentation procedure is finished, and now I'll make a preparation of a so-called double layer. I make an incision of the inner part of the flap and rotate the periost out of the flap. I prolongate the flap with the periost, and with two vertical mattress sutures, I suture first only the periost under the palatinal mucosa. With two vertical mattress sutures, I just pull the periost under the palatinal mucosa and close in the second layer the mucosa on top. So I have two layers on top of the graft. If the first layer gets open, I have the second one down. This is now my augmentation procedure. So now we will see the X-ray follow-up. You see on the X-ray follow-up, it's visible You see here on the post-op X-ray, the cortical and the cancellous part of the ring. and the function of the membrane screw. The implant is a little bit subcrustal positioned, and so I give during inserting the membrane through compression to the ring down into the local bone. 3 months later, you see, it starts up. Reorganization, and 1 year later, we have a stable healing with a stable bone around our implants. Okay, now I want to show you a step-by-step procedure on paintings. The bone ring technique is a very sensitive technique, and you need this step-by-step procedure, because if you miss maybe one point, it could be that you face a problem, and this I want to avoid, and this is why I explain everything in detail. First of all, we measure the defect, and in case bone is covering the roots from the adjacent teeth, leave a distance from approximately 1 millimeter. You see now we have 8 millimeter diameter of trephine. Then we go to the donor side, in this case the chin area, with a 9 millimeter diameter of trephine. The reason is very simple. If you harvest the ring from the donor side, the ring comes out of the inner diameter of the trephine. But if you make your ring bed preparation at the recipient side, you do it with a hole diameter, and the wall of the trephine has 0.5 millimeter. And if you use the same diameter for recipient or donor side, then you have a gap between ring and local bone from 0.5 millimeter. To avoid this gap, 1 millimeter bigger for harvesting the ring, 1 millimeter smaller for the donor side. And now first we mark only the position of the ring. We go 0.5 millimeter into the cortical bone, and then we start up the implant bed preparation. With a round drill, we mark the center of the ring with a pilot, and then this is the next instrument for the 3.5 millimeter diameter of implant from the Angelos implant system. And now I explain a very, very important detail. You see the red marking of the instrument here. This is the drill for the 3.5 millimeter diameter of Angelos implant system. But this instrument has only 2.8 millimeter diameter. And so it's really necessary to enlarge the cortical part of the ring, only the cortical part of the ring, with the next biggest drill from the implant system. This is an Angelos system 4.5 millimeter, but this instrument has only 3.7 millimeter. And so you avoid a compression of the implant during inserting through the ring into the local bone from the implant to the cortical part of the ring. That's why we enlarge always. Doesn't matter from where we harvest the bone ring, we enlarge the cortical part of the ring. Only the cortical part is the next bigger diameter. After finishing our implant bed preparation in the ring, we use a trephine for the final trephine cutting. Now we do it in the same way. We penetrate the cortical bone on the buccal side, penetrate the cancellous bone, and go in contact to the lingual cortical bone. We feel this contact very precisely. Then we have this instrument, so-called ring knife. It's a 90-degree angled instrument. With this, we cut the cancellous bone from the cortical bone on the lingual side away to make sure that we harvest as much as possible cancellous bone at the ring connected to the cortical part. With this small rasp, we remove the ring, we luxate the ring, and then we have usually a kind of ring design like that. We have a cortical and a cancellous part of the ring. And you have to consider this cancellous part of the ring is nothing else than bone marrow. And in this bone marrow, we have a lot of stem cells and growth factors. And this bone marrow, you bring in very precise contact to a refreshed local bone. And this is why this technique works so well, that you have a precise contact from the graft, especially with the bone marrow, to bleeding local bone. Okay, now we go to the recipient side and make our ring bed preparation. You remember 1 millimeter smaller diameter, and how deep we go in, depending only on the defect. If you have a 10 millimeter ring, it doesn't mean that you go 10 millimeter inside and remove all the healthy bone, of course. If the ring is too long, you can cut a little bit, but never only the defect is depending how deep you go in for the ring bed preparation. And now the ring fits very well. I told you, please put the ring from the vertical dimension to the bone level, from the bone covering the roots from the adjacent teeth. And now the ring fits very precisely without any gap between ring and local bone. And we use the ring as a template, and now it's visible. I remember 3.5 millimeter diameter of implant, the red marked instrument, and you see a gap between this instrument and the cortical bone, because I enlarge the cortical part of the ring with the next bigger diameter, and after that, the implant goes very smooth to the cortical bone without the breast fit, without rotating around, and then we have a very precise fit from the ring to the implant. And in case there is a need, you can fix the ring finally with a so-called membrane screw, and then everything is well fixed. In approximately 50% of my cases, I need this so-called membrane screw. And sometimes we have some expurated threads on the lateral, on the buckle side, for example, or some gaps. And these gaps you can fill very easily out, and you make a horizontal augmentation with particulated bone graft material. This particulated bone graft material is mixed with blood, or you can mix it also with collagenous bone chips. And this is one reason why we put a thin layer of non or slowly resorbable bone graft material on top of our graft. Another reason is we know that every bone graft, a block or a ring, doesn't matter what kind of design, has a so-called adaptation resorption in the healing period. And you can avoid this adaptation resorption if you put a thin layer of non or slowly resorbable bone graft material on top. This is the second reason why we do that. And the third reason is, if you can, with this material, you can finally design this area. It depends on the anatomical situation, of course. And if you use this particulated bone graft material, then you have to put a membrane on top. You have to fix this particulated bone graft material in place. And if you don't fix it, and for example, your patient, you just close it with a mucosa, with a mucopurital flap, and patient is eating, talking, makes some mimics, and it could be that you have a micro movement on the surface, and you get only connective tissue between the particles and not bone. So now the membrane is fixed, we have a stable situation, and this is a half of the story, because the other 50% depending on a flap without any tension. 100% of my failures, of my problems I have, it's somehow related to the soft tissue management. If your flap keeps closed, you get very, very safe, very nice result, but the biggest problem is the soft tissue management. That's why we are more and more focused on techniques how to achieve a flap without any tension. Good. This is a step-by-step procedure. If we talk about autogenous bone ring technique, then we have special areas in the intraorally from where we harvest the bone rings. You can harvest, of course, bone rings from everywhere where you find bone, but the main areas is the chin, the os palatinum, and the retromolar area. And all these areas has advantages and disadvantages. For example, the chin area has advantage, easy handling. You reach this area very easily, and you have usually a good bone volume, 4 to 5 rings you can harvest from there. And with a very good bone quality, we have a lot of cancellous bone between the two cortical layers. The disadvantage is it's sometimes a little bit more traumatic, and you have a risk of apostasy if you don't do it in the right way. From the anatomical point of view, we have to respect foramen mentale, nervus mentalis, of course, and don't avoid penetrating or fenestration to the lingual side. I told you the risk is not very big because the lingual cortical bone is a very hard one. You feel this contact very well, but please avoid. And of course, you have to take care of the roots from the lower teeth and canine, frontal teeth and canines. The os palatinum, by the way, my favorite area, because from the os palatinum we have the best bone quality what we can get intraorally. Advantage is it's really less traumatic for the patient. We have a fantastic bone quality. The disadvantage, handling could be a little bit difficult if depending on the anatomical situation, if the rooftop of the palate is a little bit steep, then you reach this area not so easily. From the anatomical point of view, take care of the sinus, roots of the neighbor teeth, and palatinal bleedings. Retromolar area, advantage, also less traumatic for the patient. Handling could be difficult if patient is not able to open very wide, because we harvest bone rings only from the crest, not from the lateral side, not from the linea obliqua externa, only from the crest. And if patient is not able to open very wide, it's sometimes not so easy to reach this area with your trephine. And we have sometimes more cortical bone. Our enemies from the anatomy are canalis mandibularis and nervus lingualis. This is a bone ring from the chin area. Then we have a bone ring from the retromolar area. And here bone rings from the os palatinum. And you see, this is an advantage. You have a perfect bone quality, and you just have to make a transposition from one ring to the defect, in this case, to the lateral incisor, and another bone ring transposition from the defect to the other side lateral incisor. And this is a big advantage. You stay at the same area. You don't have to open up another one. The big advantage. And in this photo is also very nice visible. I enlarge only the cortical part of the ring. The cancellous is in the smaller diameter. So, these are the areas from where we harvest bone rings. I write down 15 key points like a cooking book, a guideline. Please, if you want to do this technique, follow up this guideline, step-by-step procedure. And if you only miss one point, it could be that you face a problem. Let's make a short excursion into the anatomy, because if you harvest bone rings, autogenous bone rings from the interoral area, then we have a lot of anatomical structures we have to respect. We have nerves, of course. We have nerves, we have arterias, we have veins, and we have anatomical structure. I don't have to read it, you can do it by yourself. And if we, for example, go to the chin area, then please respect the minimum distance, 3 millimeters to the roots from the lower incisors and canine, to avoid devitalization, that you cut one of the branches from the nervus incisivus. And another recommendation, approximately 3 millimeters far away from the border of the chin. If you look at this CT scan, from here we would like to harvest the bone ring. These are the apex area from the lower incisor. And on this picture you see the cortical bone on the buccal side, the cortical bone on the lingual side, double thick than the cortical bone on the buccal side, with a lot of cancellous bone in between. And this is why you feel this contact very precisely. Nervus mentalis is always in danger if you harvest the bone rings from, if you make implantation in premolar area, if you do a perioral transition in this area, or harvesting bone rings or bone from the chin. Mistake is in the most of the cases, sorry, a wrong incision, or that you don't see this anatomical structure, the foramen mentale, on your panoramic X-ray. Then please make a CT scan. When we're running 3, 4, 5 times, depending a human cadaver courses in Vienna, we're working on fresh human cadavers, and I want to show you some anatomical details on fresh human cadaver pictures. This is a fresh human cadaver. You see the chin area, and here you see the nervus mentalis. The nervus mentalis has usually 3 branches, and if you look at this picture, one branch is running very close to the mesial, one is running more to the distal area, but they are somewhere everywhere over here, very superficial under the gingiva. And you see, I make a red, yellow arch into this picture. This yellow arch is a recommendation, and this you have to understand, it's a recommendation from what is written, or recommendation from a teaching book for surgeons, to make an incision like that for harvesting bone from here, apexectomy, whatever. But you can imagine, if you do this kind of incision and you cut one of the branches, then patient has a parastasy. This is the biggest mistake what you can do. And this is one of the reasons why many people say don't touch the chin. The risk is too big to get a parastasy. We recommend to make only this kind of incision. 1-2 millimeter down from the mucogingiva border, parallel from canine to canine, and one vertical in the middle. And then you can imagine if you do it like that. And please cut the mental muscle at his attachment from canine to canine parallel, and one vertical in the middle. And then you are far away from these branches from the mental nerve. And if you do it like that, you can harvest safely bone from the chin area. And if you, of course, to respect the distance from the apex area from canines and frontal teeth, then you can very safely harvest bone rings from the chin area. Sometimes we have anastomosis running from one side to another. You know, sometimes the canal is visible running from one side to another. Here you see it a little bit more in detail. Please, this you have to consider, of course. Arteria sublingualis and submentalis. I told you the risk of fenestration is not that big, but if you make a destruction or implantation in the frontal area and you fenestrate to the lingual side, you can get a very, very strong arterial bleeding, and this could be dangerous for the life of the patient. It's visible on this picture. Here are a lot of big blood vessels running, and if you get an arterial bleeding over here, this is a really very badly complicated complication. Arteria facialis is another enemy anteriofaciales is running. If you harvest the bone from the ramus, it could be that you come a little bit close, but it's not a big risk. But of course, we know it from the literature that sometimes people make injury into the arteria facialis, and then you can get, of course, a very big arterial bleeding. And this is a blood supply from the floor of the mouth, and you see a lot of big blood vessels running even to the mesial thigh part. And if you penetrate one of them, it could be get a very strong arterial bleeding. We harvest the bone rings from the crest, never from the linea obliqua externa. From here, you have maybe 4 or 5 millimeter, and then you are close to the mandibular channel. That's why this is not enough for us for a bone ring. And here we are far away from the, of course, from the arteria facialis. And here you see the arteria facialis. The risk is not very big, but you have to be aware that she's running somewhere here. And if you open up this artery, I told it all the time, it's just a joke what I tell now, then please wait 10 minutes, then bleeding stops by itself because patient is empty. Good. Then we make also some external studies and look at some anatomical details in our anatomical courses in Vienna. Good. Now let's talk about os palatinum, my favorite area for harvesting bone rings. In case, let's guess, this canine is missing and you have a huge bone defect over here, then exactly between the adjacent teeth in the edentulous part of the maxilla, we harvest the bone rings from the palate with the best quality. And you can very easily, if you have a edentulous area, also cut the nervous incisivus. This makes no problem for the patient. And if you look at the CT scan, we have a big amount of bone on the palate for harvesting. But don't try to harvest bone rings on top of roots. This is very dangerous. Only in edentulous areas, and then you can harvest in a very good quality, very nice rings from the os palatinum. Blood supply from the os palatinum, everyone knows arteria palatita comes out here, dividing in many smaller arterias running to the mesial. And if you, for example, harvest a connective tissue graft or a bone ring and you open up of a smaller artery, you can get a strong arterial bleeding. But this is not a big complication usually, because we stay more in the frontal area. We never try to harvest bone or something here in this area, because if you do it in this area, the bleeding is not a big complication. You can usually very easily stop this bleeding. This is not a problem. So now let's talk about nervus alveolaris inferior. This is in danger if you make implantation in distal area and bone harvesting from the ramus. Please do a panoramic, if you don't see this canal on the panoramic X-ray, make a CT scan or a DVT. And if you look again to the distal molar area, we harvest bone rings from here and never from the linea obliqua externa, only from the crest. And if you harvest the bone blocks, this is again human cadaver picture from the ramus, this could be that you somehow exposure of the nerve. And if you have a situation like that you have a canal is visible inside of your graft, then, and you have exposure of the nerve, then please don't put something on top, just close it. Don't, no membrane, no bone graft material, please just close it. Nervus lingualis is waiting on the other side. It's in danger if you have implantation region number 7, bone harvesting from the retromolar area. Please make the right incision. And if you can, please protect this anatomical structure. If you look at this, this is our recommendation, again, human cadaver picture for a right incision if you harvest bone rings from the retromolar area. Similar to an incision what you should do if you make ostomy of a wisdom tooth. This is the lingual nerve, and the lingual nerve is running very close to the surface of the bone on the lingual side. This you have to know and you remember. You see, this is a lingual nerve running very close to the surface. And if you try to protect the nerve like that, then it could be that the nerve is running between instrument and bone, in between here. If you try to protect the nerve, please go in bony contact between lingual nerve and lingual bone. And if you fenestrate, then the nerve is of course protected. And if you don't protect him and you drill into the nerve and you rupture the nerve, then you have to suture him. This is of course not our job. This is our Anatomical Institute in Vienna. We have space for 40 participants and we are working only on fresh human cadavers. It's like make a surgery on living human people. We are well equipped. We have space again for 40 people. Each couple share one head and I have a so-called master skull. I show all the exercises and this is monitored to the screens and we make 80% only hands-on course. We have international participants. We speak only English, people coming from all over the world. This is my partner and friend, Norbert Fock. He's from Austria, from Germany. And we during the course, we sometimes wear all the Austrian trousers. And of course, in the evening, we drink a glass of wine. This is included, usually. One man from Germany and one man from India. So this is our human cadaver course from Botis Company. If you join us, you will be have a lot of nice experience to work on this fresh human cadavers. I really can recommend this course. Not only because I am there, of course there's also Norbert Fock and my other partner from Lithuania, Darius Pochibutas. Now let's talk about indications. What can we do with the bone ring technique? We can do almost everything. There's only one contraindication, I will show you later. I use the bone ring technique in approximately 99% of all three-dimensional augmentation procedures. This is an indication I like to recommend to start with. It's a premolar defect at the premolar or maxilla. And this is a very easy case, but very nice to start with the bone ring technique. And you see the crest is a very thin one, but getting bigger to the bottom. And this is a ring. And you see how nice this ring is looking. Cortical and cancellous parts. This is bone marrow crying for revascularization because this bone marrow contains stem cells and growth factors. And this you bring in a very precise contact bleeding to bleeding local bone. First of all, we make a pilot drill and then we use a trephine with a pin for the ring bed preparation and we create a nice bleeding ring bed. You see it here. And then we put the ring inside. And you can imagine that this now is very precise contact from the ring to the local bone. And another advantage from this ring technique is the design by itself. You can very nicely reconstruct the design of the maxilla like jugum alveolare. Bone graft particles on top, membrane on top, suturing. Then this is a half year later. You see we have a very nice revascularization and reconstruction of the bone. Now you have to do only impression for the new crowns. This is the only case indication where you can't do the ring technique. If you have a very, very thin crest and the crest is parallel thin down to the bottom. And in cases like that, you have to make a lateral augmentation with a bone block or other techniques, but here you can't use the ring technique. Now, let's have a look to another case. I will show you some cases. We have not so much time, just to give you a little bit idea, a general idea about the technique. We have a huge defect in the frontal area, canine and lateral incisor. You see a huge defect. And then I go one floor down just for harvesting the rings over here and make a compensation of this defect with the bone rings. And this is a half year later, the healing of the soft tissue, the re-entry. And then I make re-entry and make a gingiva graft to fill up the gap between gingiva formers. And then we suture around gingiva formers. And this is the 1 and 2 years later prosthetic restoration. This man was at that time when I do the surgery 88 years old. Now he's 90 years old. He's not a perfect hygiene, but you see, we can reconstruct the bone very nicely. And he said, I'm 90, I don't need teeth in the distal area because I just want to have bone rings and fixed crowns over here. This is an X-ray follow-up from the case from here we are coming. Here is post-op 6 months later and 2 years later you see the full reconstruction of this area after 2 years. Now I show you a case how we can harvest the bone rings from the os palatinum. Os palatinum, I told you my favorite. This is a case I did together with my friend Darius Pochibutas from Lithuania. And I did the surgery, did the prosthetic. We had two big defects in the lateral incisor maxilla And we on a treatment plan was to make extraction of the central incisor and to make socket preservation and harvest two rings from the palate, one here, from one from here to here, socket preservation, and later a bridge from two to two with two overt pointings. This was the amount of bone what we can get from the palate. And then I make extraction, raise the flap to the buccal side, raise the flap to the palate, cut the nervus incisivus. And I told you, take care of the arterias. And then I mark the position of the rings and make an implant bed preparation into the rings, enlarging the cortical part of the ring. And now I make a transposition from one ring to here, one ring from here to here. And this is my favorite picture. This is the bone rings stored in the blood of the patient. Look at how nice it is. This photo is, of course, done by accident, but look how nice it looks. It's art. Tomato soup, bone rings. Now rings are out of, and now the first ring bed preparation on one side, put the ring inside from the vertical dimension to the bone level, from the bone around the defect, on the other side the same. And now this is a picture from the occlusion view. And again, here you see how nice we can reconstruct this design of the maxilla with its bone rings. There's no other graft design where you can do it nicely like that. This is another advantage, of course. And then we cover each ring separately with a membrane and with bone graft material. And we fix the membrane with another two titanium pins on the palate. And then if you make a purest incision on the buccal side, take care of the nervus infraorbitalis, because if we make purest incision to cover each ring separately, we have to make a purest incision over here to release the flap. And please take care of the nervus infraorbitalis, because also the nervus infraorbitalis has three branches and one is running very close to the floor of the nose. Here you see the nervus infraorbitalis. And if you do purest incision, do it a little bit more lower down, not too much under the floor of the nose. Then, after closure of the rings, I remove the epithelium, I refresh the gingiva, fill up the defects with bone graft material, you see here around, go to the other side from the palate with a trephine, harvest two gingiva grafts, like that, and cover the sockets with two gingiva grafts. Now you see the augmentation procedure is done. One bone ring from here to here, one from here to here, and two gingiva grafts to cover the sockets. This is X-ray 3 months later. This is a soft tissue healing 3 months later. 6 months later, you see we have a nice healing. And then my colleague did re-entry, so-called meander technique, to create papillas. It's a usual procedure in the aesthetic zone. And then we have abutments, temporary abutments, and my colleague did screw-retained labmade temporaries to create now overt pointings over here. And after, this is 7 months later, the X-ray control, for me is very important that we have the bone level very stable around the implants. And you see, after some weeks, we have nice overt pointings, the ceramic abutments already in place. And I cut the frenulum to release, to remove the tension from the to the papilla incisivus. And this is a prosthetic part. From here we are coming with the two bone rings, you remember. And this is an aesthetic zone. And this is 1 year after loading. You see we have a very stable bone around. Everything is revascularized and bone is on the shoulder of the implant. This is bone ring technique and ostpalatinum. And now, what is for me one of the most nice indications, the sinus lifting. You know, very often we have a sinus situation that we have papers in sinus floor, maybe half a millimeter only, not enough to achieve a primary stability, not enough to achieve a primary stability. And usually in cases like that, you go for a two-step surgery. It means you have to make first augmentation of the sinus and then some months later implantation. But with a bone ring technique, you can do both together. And we do it in that way. I will explain. We make a lateral approach, lateral window, make a mobilization of the sniderial membrane up. then we fill up the sinus mesial distal palatinal with particulated bone graft material and put the ring into the sinus. Let's say this sinus floor has only maybe half a millimeter or eggshell thin sinus floor. And then we turn the ring around. Now the cancellous part is on the sinus floor. The reason is why we do that. The sinus floor is usually concave designed. It is much more easier to adapt the soft part of the ring to the concave design sinus floor. That's why we turn the ring around. But if you do so, then you are not allowed to enlarge the cortical part of the ring. Then leave it in this diameter, otherwise you can't achieve your stability. And then we insert our implant through the sinus floor into the ring, and from outside we fix it with a membrane screw. So we connect the thin sinus floor inside with a ring, outside with a membrane screw, and achieve a primary stability in paper thin sinus floor. We do this routinely, and it's very, very seldom that we have to do two-step surgery in sinus floor elevations. Just a clinical case for that. You have a huge defect, the second premolar maxilla left side, and the paper thin sinus floor, half a millimeter or millimeter. Very difficult defect design. This is a clinical photo. Then I make a lateral approach to the sinus, make a mobilization of the Schneiderian membrane up, and go to the chin, harvest two rings. And now you see the rings in the butt of the patient. One ring, I enlarge the cortical part, and one ring, I don't enlarge. This one is for the sinus, because I turn him around, and this one is for the compensation of the defect from the second premolar. Now I fill up the sinus with bone graft material, mesial distal palatinal, put the ring inside, cortical part up, cancellous part down. And I keep the ring from the crest, from the top with a rasp during inserting my implant. And then from outside I fix him with a membrane screw. So you achieve a perfect stability in paper thin bone, ring inside, implant, membrane screw. The second ring I use for that compensation of the defect from the second premolar. And fix it also with a membrane screw, and you see now one ring inside, one ring outside. Bone graft material on top, and this is the X-ray post-op, the two rings coming from here, one ring for the compensation of the defect second premolar, one ring in the sinus. And this is already 4 years later, from here we are coming, and now you see we have stable bone around here for the compensation of this defect, and also in the sinus we have stable bone, bone is on the shoulder of the implant. This is our standard procedure nowadays to make bone rings for the stabilization of the implant in the sinus. This is another very nice indication, the malposition of a canine. You know, it sometimes we can't put him on the right place with the orthodontic treatment, and sometimes patients, of course, don't want it. And we do only one-step surgery. We make an osteotomy. The canine is located somewhere here, and then we make an osteotomy. And after with this, we create a huge defect, and go to the chin for harvesting a bone ring. Of course, what else? Oops. Why I can't hire. And then I create a ring bed preparation, put the ring inside, and fix the ring with an implant. And you see subcrestal position a little bit, 1 millimeter approximately, and the gaps on the palate I fill up with particulated bone chips. And so I have a compensation of the huge defect with a ring and implant directly in one surgery. Bone graft material on top, membrane, of course. This is the occlusion view. Implant should always be on the right position, of course, and closure of the flap. Then half year later, you see the healing is perfect. You see nothing. And this is the chin area from where we harvest the ring. And then we have a temporary crown first. This is a transfer key for the temporary abutment. This is a temporary crown. And then we have a ceramic crown without papillas, and 3 months later with papillas, just to wait. This is the final situation. And we do everything in one-step surgery from here to here. This is routine in our clinic that we do this always in one step. So, my friends, now let's talk about, of course, my friends and girlfriends. I hope that there are some women also watching. I know one in Serbia is looking and watching, and This is now the most difficult part in our field of dental implantology, the hyatrophic distal mandibula. And if you have a patient like that, for example, and he wants to have implants here, of course you can do all on four, but if you want to keep this and you want to make a augmentation, then in the past we did first nerve lateralization, hip graft, vertical augmentation, and some months later implants. But you know the risk. If you do vertical augmentation or nerve lateralization with hip graft, nerve lateralization is always a little bit risk that patient get a discomfort, let's say only discomfort, sometimes of course also prosthesy. And hip graft is not calculable how fast and how much it gets resorbed. We do it nowadays only with bone rings. This was my first case now 8 years ago. Patient comes like that and we have only 5 millimeters down to the mandibular channel, and we know that we have to keep a distance from approximately 1-2 millimeter, so we lose another millimeter or 2 millimeters, and then we have only this part who would from the implant would achieve a primary stability. But we also have to create a ring bed like that. It means we have to remove the cortical bone over here to create a ring bed, because now the blood supply comes out here into the ring. So we lose another little bit from the bone, and this is, I tell you, you need an implant system for the bone ring technique if you make cases like that, where you can achieve a primary stability even if you have only 2 or 3 threads fixed in the local bone. And the blood supply, of course, comes now only from here. And I show you the clinical case, the two rings coming from here, 1, 2, for the vertical augmentation. And this is 3 months later, and this is re-entry 6 months later. And at that time, I don't know that it's a good idea to put bone graft, non-resorbable bone graft material around the ring. And this is why I lose a little bit from the bone, a little bit of resorption. Here, 0.5 millimeter is not a big problem, but not idle. We know we want to have it like here, bone on the shoulder of the implant. This is 6 months later, and this is already 2 years later. We're coming from here, and we are here 2 years later. You see, we have a stable bone around everything. The vertical augmentation, the bone comes up, and this is 6 years later. Look at the bone, stable bone without any resorption, and you remember from where we are coming. And this gives me so much hope when I see this case that I do more and more, and nowadays I do vertical augmentation only with bone rings in one step. Look at this case. We have only 3 millimeter down to the mandibular channel. And because I know that it works so well, I make reconstructions like that. One implant here, augmentation with a bone ring. You see it from here to here. And later a bridge with two cantilevers in the middle. And this is 5 years later. Look at that from here to here. Look how stable the bone is around our implant with one-step surgery with a bone ring. Cases like that are routine in our clinic. We have 5 rings over here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 rings coming from the chin area. We call it Audi Quattro technique. You know, Audi is a German car, and this is why we like it. And now I show you the procedure. Here we have a huge defect. No. Ah, here. Huge defect over here. And I'd go one floor down for harvesting the bone ring and make a compensation of the defect with the bone ring. And now the implant is inside of the defect. And now we fill up the defect with bone graft material. It's like a sinus lifting in the mandibula. You see the other rings coming from here. 1, 2, 3, 4. And the membrane for the frontal defect. And 1, 2 rings here for vertical augmentation, 1 here. And here the implant was only 1 or 2 millimeter exponated. So in this area I use only particulated bone graft material, just make some bleeding points inside. And this is X-ray post-op, 1, 2, 3, 4 rings, ring inside of the defect. Then 6 months later, 1 year later with a prosthetic reconstruction, 4 years later. You see, you have a stable bone always around the implant. And this is already 6 years later. Look at that. No resorption. Everything is stable around with all these 4 rings. And this is really a reliable technique if you do it like that. This is also a case, Nothing special. Three rings for vertical augmentation is at the distal mandibular right side. You see three rings, 1, 2, 3. Post-op, 6 months post-op. This is a photo from the intra-operation situs. The rings are connected to each other. And this is a photo is not that good, but you see the rings are growing together after re-entry. And this is only the tunnel of the cover screw. The diameter of the implant is like that. So it shows that the bone is growing onto the shoulder of the implant. And this shows only here the rings are revascularized. 6 months later, you see. And this is 4 years later. From here we are coming, and here we are 4 years later with the vertical augmentation. And now we have a nice relation from the length of the implants to the crowns, and this is how it looks like clinically. Okay, now let's go to the main part of my presentation, because now we talking about our new project. This is a project what we did, and I'm very proud that you are one of the first participants of a lecture. I can show you our results. I make a short excursion into the history. This was a case how it starts. This patient comes to my clinic, edentulous maxilla, normal, nothing special, but if you look to the x-ray, it's really very special. You see we have zero bone on the sinus floor of the nose, no bone, and also here no bone. And look at this, there was on top a septum running from mesial to distal. And if you look to the age of the patient, she was only 37 years old and comes to my clinic like that. And then we do it in that way. I make first the sinus lifting right side, you see the septum, and behind the septum is another Schneiderian membrane, and I have to make another window, because otherwise I can't insert an implant, and I make a sinus lifting in the sinus. You see it on this picture, there's a sinus, another window. And then we have so-called allografts, you know, allografts are bone grafts from human, and we have cancellous blocks, and out of these cancellous blocks, I make a preparation of two rings and make a vertical augmentation with these two rings. And on the other side, I use cortico-cancellous rings for vertical augmentation. And in the middle, I put a block to make it even. And then put bone graft particles around and close it. This is X-ray post-op. You remember we're coming from the zero bone, and now after maybe 2-3 hours later, we have 9 implants. Sinus lifting in the sinus, and we go on with the procedure. This is 3 months later. You see, bone looks stable. Someone wants me to drink something. I will do. There's no alcohol. It's only water. Alcohol we drink after. So now, from here we are coming, and this is 6 months later, the healing of the soft tissue. I go for re-entry. It doesn't look so different like before, but stable. Then I take a histological probe with a trephine and close around the gingiva formers. This was a patient before, and this is she now the same patient with a new prosthetic. And from here we are coming, you remember. This is a trephine result. With a histological result for what are coming out of the trephine. We have vital osteocytes, we have bone, and we have osteoclasten, we have osteoid, and of course our vital bone. You can't expect that bone 7-8 millimeter vertical height is completely revascularized after a half year. But this case gives me so much hope that we are on the right way, that we continue, of course. And the logical consequence was to produce prefabricated rings and make it more easier for the patient. And we use now these prefabricated rings coming from living donors. We don't use a dead human, we use only living donors. And if someone gets a hip substitute, then they cut the femur ball, and out of this bone we create these prefabricated bone rings. And very important, the very fine selection of the patients, and also the medical history and the bone quality should be very well selected. And we have rings in 10 millimeter length and 6 and 7 millimeter diameter, and the inner diameter 3.4 millimeter for the 3.5 millimeter of implant. Good. What can we do now? This is how it comes from the company, and I will show you now what we can do with that. The advantage of this prefabricated rings is now that we can plan everything very precisely, because now we have all the information what we need. We need the length of the ring, we need the anatomical situation, and also we know what kind of length of implant we want to use now. If you use an autolog ring, you never know how long is your ring after harvesting it from the chin, from the palate, or from the retromolar area. So, if you do it like that, with these allo rings, you have now all information for a precise planning. And then this is a ring, and it's again 10 millimeter length, and you can very easily cut it in two rings, 5 millimeter. This is what we do very often, because you never need 10 millimeter length of rings. The average is 4 to 6 millimeter length of rings we use. And you can make out of one, two rings. And this is a tree find with a pin, because if you go, for example, for vertical augmentation in the mandibular, we make a pilot drilling, and then we use this instrument, the tree find with a pin, put the pin into the pilot drill here, and then the pin guides the tree find to mark the ring bed, just to mark the ring bed. And then we have an instrument like that, we call it flattening instrument, and with this you reduce the cortical bone until it's bleeding. You create a ring bed like that. And this is ideal for the augmentation with a bone ring, if you have a bleeding ring bed like that. But if you can't go deeper because you come too close to the mandibular channel and it's not bleeding, or you use primary stability with your implant and you has to stay like this, then I recommend to make bleeding points into this ring bed, because you need now the blood supply coming from the local bone into the ring. And this is how it should look like later. And then we do it like that. We remove sharp edges. This is always very important. Never leave some sharp edges around your graft. And please fill up the defect in between with bone graft particles and fix it with a membrane. And make a safe closure for this vertical augmentation. And we don't have to hydrate the rings anymore. We just put the rings in position, and some seconds later, they are full with blood, and this is what we want to have. Okay, and now I want to show you some clinical cases, what we can do with this ring, with this allo rings, and also I want to show you the histological results. If you look at this case, it comes from my friend Chris Chmielewski from Poland, and I did the surgery in Frankfurt, and he makes the photos together with Orchan Yüksel. And look at that. We have no bone on the sinus floor, and also no bone at the floor of the nose, and hypertrophic mandibula on both sides. And then I open up the sinus one side, and you see again paper thin bone on the sinus floor. Not big enough for primary stability, and now it's very easy. Just open a box, take a bone ring, an allo ring, put it into the sinus, and fix this ring with an implant. A very easy done. And put bone graft material around. This is really very easy, and you can achieve a perfect stability in paper thin bone on the sinus floor. And close, put a membrane on top and close it. The other side was even more worse. There was no bone at all over here. You see, I make a lateral window to the sinus, then I take a tree find and remove this no bone, and then I fix a bone ring between mesial distal crestal bone. Now the ring is only fixed with a breast fit between mesial distal crestal bone, and the implant is fixed by the ring. So we have in no bone now a ring with an implant, and then we put bone graft material around and close it. Now we go to the lower jaw, same case. One side, ring bed preparation for the vertical augmentation, ring inside. You look how nice it, precise it fits, and fix it with a ring. Two rings one side, and two rings on the other side. This is always the same case. And now, 6 months later, my friend did the re-entry. You see here the rings and the sinus on both sides, the re-entry. And you see the lower jaw with a vertical augmentation on both sides with two rings after re-entry. And this was the x-ray before. And now the x-ray after, 3 months later, the rings in the sinus. And here, more worse, and the two vertical augmentation with the two bone rings in the lower jaw. And this is 1 year after loading. You see, we have stable bone around everywhere and also with the bone rings from the vertical augmentation in the maxilla and mandibula. And this is, we always, all the cases I show you now, we take after 6 to 12 months histological probes during the re-entry. And this is what is the content of the tree fine from the histological probe. And now look at that. This is new bone with a star, you see new bone. And this is allograft. Look how the new bone grows into the allograft and how they are connected to each other. This is amazing for me to see that from all sides, new bone is growing into the allograft. Look at this. This is an empty lacoon, this is allograft, and this is the new bone cells. Everywhere the same. And here you see allograft. The allograft is surrounded by new bone cells. This is for me really amazing to see that. Here again, allograft, new bone cells. Allograft, new bone cells. And we have osteoclasts over here. New bone. Amazing results for me. And we have a lot of papers about allografts. We know it's a very safe technique, and many papers are written that we don't have to show that allografts are working. We only combine bone ring technique and allograft technique. Look at this case. This man comes to our clinic in Frankfurt with two malposition canines, a real shitty case, look at that. And this man told us, please, I want to have implants over here, but I have no money. But I told him no money is a contraindication for implants. But he said, of course, I said, of course I will make implants for you because this case is so nice, but I want to do it in my way. And he said, please do. And then we make osteotomy of the canines, and as a defect we fill up with a, now what happens now? And the defect we fill up with a bone ring, and the rest of the defect we fill up with bone graft particles of top. This is one side. Other side, you see one side here on this side, osteotomy, bone ring, and implants. Other side, more big defect. If you look at this, a huge defect. There's no bone at all. I put a bone ring inside again, fix it with an implant, and you have to put two bone rings on top of each other because the defects were so big, and close it with membrane before I fill up all the gaps with bone graft particles. And 9 months later, re-entry, only bone. This is only bone around, nothing else. And this is an x-ray post-op 6 months later, you see, we have only stable bone around our implants. Re-entry was done from here we are coming, you remember. This is 10 months later x-ray. From here we are coming. One step surgery, osteotomy, and rings and implants in one step. Histological probe, look at that. Again, we did histological probe. You can read it by yourself maybe. This is allograft, new bone cells, everywhere over here. You see the allograft and so nicely connected to each other. It's amazing for me that the whole allograft ring is now inside fresh, new, trabeculate structured bone cells. And this is now that prosthetic with four locators. We did prosthetic for this man. Good. Look at this case. Another one. We had situation, frontal layer, huge defect over here. And if you look at this defect, this cries for a bone ring. This is a very nice indication for a bone ring, to put a bone ring, allograft ring inside, fix it with an implant. And you see how nice we reconstruct this area. And then we make lateral augmentation to increase the volume to get a more nice designed situation with particulated bone graft material. Put a membrane on top and suture. This is now the temporary during the healing period. And this is the X-ray post-op. You see the rings are here in the frontal area. And this is the X-ray. And this is 6 months later, the healing. And then we try and start create ovoid pointex. And here we do the re-entry. And you see here, bone is growing on top of the implant. This is an allograft ring. And even here, everything is growing. It means if you wait maybe 10 months, then the whole implant is completely covered by bone. And we take a histological probe again, like always. And you see the same situation, allograft and new bone cells are very close connected to each other. Everywhere the same. If you look at that, allograft connected by own bone cells. This is now the situation with the X-ray 7 months later. And look at this case. Patient comes to our clinic like that. And what would we do in one step extraction? Looks not very nice, but it is like it is. And then we create this kind of defects. Now, this kind of defects here. And I take one autogenous ring from the lateral side, distally from this defect, and make a compensation of this defect with an autogenous ring. And the other ring, I use an allo ring, I cut it on the right to the right size, and then I make a compensation of this defect with the allo ring. Now I have an autogenous ring and an allo ring next to each other. So this is one side. Other side, look at this huge defect over here. One allo ring and another one. Two allo rings on the other side for the compensation of these defects. And a bone graft material on top and suturing. Now this is the X-ray post-op. One ring comes from here to here, autogenous, one allo ring here, one allo ring here, and one allo ring here. Then my friend and colleague in Lithuania did the re-entry, and he has to do, after opening, everywhere he has to use a ball drill, round drill, to remove the bone to reach the cover screw. Every implant was completely covered by bone. You see it here. He has to use a round drill. You see no implant. The round drill, and to remove the bone on top of the cover screw. Again over here. And then we take histological probes, like always, what we did, and put gingiva formers in. And now this is the X-ray 6 months later. Look at that. From here, one ring is coming, one allo ring, autogenous ring, allo ring, allo ring. Everything is very stable, only covered by bone. And the histological result shows already the same. We have new bone, we have allograft bone, everything is very nice, easily connected. Without necrosis, without resorption, everything is stable. And from here we are coming, you remember. Okay, now this case, very funny, not funny, but interesting situation, because this patient comes to our clinic like that. And she had this kind of defect, very difficult defect. And on top, the biggest punishment for implantologist is if people like that have a gummy smile. If she smiles, you see everything till here. So now we have to reconstruct everything in the natural way. She needs papillas, she needs bone. And the funny thing is, this patient wears a removable denture or a temporary since 8 years, because she had two or three failed augmentation procedures, and she was so. And she said, I don't want to have anything more. And then she gets the knowledge about bone rings and comes to our clinic. And we did it like that. I measure the defect, one bigger tree fine for the central incisor, one smaller for the lateral incisor. I take one ring from the chin and make an augmentation for this one ring for the central incisor, and fix it with an implant. And then we do it in that way. I make it scallop designed to support the papilla between the two implants. First ring in position, and for the other ring, I use an allo ring. So I have now autogenous and allo ring next to each other. Right position, of course, and now you see how nicely we reconstruct the jugum alveolare, and fix the two rings with an implant. You remember allograft ring, autogenous ring. And then again, I take the diamond ball and make a scallop designed preparation to support the papilla incisiva, the papilla between the two rings. This is a photo after. And then we make PRF membranes, plated with fibrin membranes, and we particulate one membrane and mix it with particulated bone graft material. We use Cerabone. Cerabone is a bovine material. We mix it with a PRF membrane, and then we put a Jason membrane on top. Jason membrane is also from the Botis company. This is a pericard from a pig. I like this membrane very much. And on top of this membrane, we put PRF membranes. And then, you see from the crest, and then we close the flap. And what we do nowadays routinely is that we make so-called apical mitral sutures. This apical mitral suture has the advantage that the tension of the lip stops here and don't go to this area where we connect buccal and palatinal gingiva. The tension stops here. This is a very nice technique. And this is a situation after suturing, X-ray post-op, and healing of the soft tissue 1 week later. And now the advantage of the PRF membrane is, for me, a big advantage. Sometimes, if you see that you get a little bit opening of the flap, a little bit dehiscence, then you can leave it because the PRF membrane is down and you can expect that it will be closed by open cannulation, by open healing. And this is now the situation 6 months later. We have already papilla here and papilla here, but here we have to create a papilla, of course. And this is the situation after 6 months, you see, gummy smile. And we need everything in the right position. And the X-ray, you don't see a difference between autogenous ring and allo ring. And this is a temporary. This patient is now under temporary because now we wait only to that papilla is growing in here and then we make the final restoration. What we did on top, we take a histological probe and you can expect the same result. New bone, allograft bone. You see in this picture already an allograft bone is incorporated in new bone cells. Amazing for me how it reacts to each other. Look at this, allograft bone is incorporated in new bone. Look at this, allograft everywhere, new bone from all sides. This is really amazing. Here, look at that allograft, new bone cells around. The same over here. This makes me so full of hope that we can use maybe in the same way allograft bone rings like autogenous bone rings. But again, we only do that in 3 years and the results looking very nice. And I'm really full of hope that we can do it in that way. And finally, I want to show you now a video how we did this case. The same case, the last case I show you in video. We did this video in Frankfurt. And now I hope I can get here it is. I measure the defect, you remember. Then we find the right implant position to mark the position of the implant. Now I make a pilot drill, and after this pilot drill, I use a tree find with a pin and mark the ring position. You see, now first ring is in position, next implant position, lateral incisor. Pilot. And now ring bed preparation, the tree find with a pin, you remember I told you already. And then I try check the fit of the ring, and then I have to bring the ring to the right size and fix him with an implant. Okay, and now fixing the ring with an implant. You see, I keep the ring with my fingers, removing the adapters. And now I start up to design the ring a little bit, to make a little bit scalloped design in between the implants to support the papilla and remove, of course, sharp edges. It's always very important. Now I put a thin layer of bone graft particles on top, mixed with a PRF membrane. I fix the chosen membrane with two titanium pins. And now we put the PRF membranes on top of the chosen membrane. The PRF membrane, I'm a big fan of that because they have a very good effect for the soft tissue healing, of course. And now I make this apical matter sutures. You see, I make two apical matter sutures, and then the tension stops here and doesn't go to this area where we connect the buccal and palatinal. You see, the tension stops here. And that's a big advantage with this so-called apical matter sutures. Okay. And now, this is our Max Kraft bone ring, prefabricated. And now I want to show you the next slide, but it doesn't work somehow. Now, this is our anatomical course in Vienna. I told you, please, if you have the chance, if you possibility, join us. It is amazing course. No, not again, because I'm running this course together with my friends, but you can see a lot of things you haven't seen for a long time, also from the anatomical point of view. And with this, I want to say thank you very much for your attention, and now I'm ready to answer your questions. Thank you very much and have a nice evening wherever you are. And I want to say thank you to my friend and especially to my special one in Serbia. So now I read some questions. There's a question. How they can contact me more to get about? Is there a way we can contact you to get more information about this particular technique? Of course you can. Just go to our website and you find all this informations where we have courses. Of course you can also contact us directly with emails. And there is a question. In case of the atrophic maxilla, what do you think about zygomatic implants like Pranamaxium? I have never done, and I'm really not a fan of that, because I know some cases where patient has problems to remove this zygomatic implants. And I think we have so many tools to make a vertical or three-dimensional augmentation, and that we don't need this kind of techniques. Another question, very interesting, thanks a lot for your presentation. What are the contraindications for the bone ring augmentation? I told you, contraindication is a very, 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 very thin crest where you can't fix an implant. And then, and usually for this kind of cases, you only can't make a lateral block augmentation, because sometimes it's too thin that you also even can't do a splitting or spreading. Then this is a real contraindication. And other contraindications are the same from the medical point of view. Of course, this is a little bit too much to talk about today, but contraindications are, of course, some medical histories, osteoradionecrosis, maybe strong smokers, but it is up to you. But usually there are no other contraindications like a very, very thin crest. Okay. But I think the most interesting question I already answered. Okay, there's another question. How is a management of soft tissue? How is the management of soft tissue in the posterior area for vertical augmentation? This is a very good question, because I told you, you have to take care of the nervus mentalis if you make pubis incision on the buccal side, maybe in region number 3 to 6. And we do releasing the flap only from the lingual side. We make a preparation of the lingual flap, and then we try to make a very, very long incision. And so the flap gets a little bit more elasticity, but the most elasticity we take from the lingual side. To our Vesta, there's another question. If I show videos, of course, I can't do it now, because I can't show videos from different areas. But then you have to come to a course, and then I can show you everything. This is only to give you an idea and to appetize you for this technique. But this, if you just watch this webinar, I please don't try to do it, because it is not so easy like it looks like, and you need a little bit experience, and you have to follow really very well the step-by-step procedure. Okay, that's it from my side. And I guess there are many more questions, but I think we're running out of time now. And it's up to you. If you want to have more questions, you can also contact me directly with email or with on a website. And also the company of Botis can forward everything what you want to know to me directly. And so thank you again for your attention. It was a big pleasure for me to do this webinar. And I hope that some of you will do it and contact me. And if you have questions, again, this offer, you can contact me all the time, every time. Thank you very much, and bye-bye.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gisenhagen, for sharing your lecture and your insightful information with us. We would also like to thank Botis for making this online course possible. And thank you, our wonderful audience, for your interest and participation. The recording will be posted online within the next 48 hours. You will receive an email notification with a link to the recording. Further questions regarding the lecture today may be submitted directly on the website on the courses page under the Ask the Expert tab. So please go ahead and submit your questions, and Dr. Gisenhagen will be sure to get back to you as soon as possible. Please be sure to visit Dental Dreaming Study Club's Focus Educational Platform, www.digistudyclub.com, and keep an eye out for our growing schedule of online courses. Thank you again to all. Take care and goodbye.